John chapter 8, verse 36, Jesus says, "Who the Son sets free is free indeed." And my friends, they're the most free people I know. But freedom isn't just something they have. They encompass freedom. And everywhere our squad shows up gets a very infectious taste of it. We're free. We're consumed by love. And we're an unstoppable force to be reckoned with. We're dreamers, paradigm shifters, and most of the time, absolute goofballs. And I wholeheartedly believe we're going to change the world.
Generation, and I'm your host, Ben Courson. Today's episode is entitled Joyful, Confident Welcome. It takes a lot of strength to not get jaded the older we get, but I say the older we get, the more childlike we should become. It's interesting when an 8-year-old is reading a story, he has to see that Johnny opened a door and there was a dragon behind the door in order to keep his interest piqued. But when a 2-year-old just sees that Johnny opened a door, that in itself amazes him. To a child, everything is magical and filled with wonder. And Jesus told us to become like kids again. So let's learn how we can become more childlike, because indeed, children have yet to learn that there is anything that isn't music. Children have yet to learn that there is anything that isn't music. Children have yet to learn that there is anything that isn't music. And when they hear the battle drum beat of the Lord's heart, that is the beat of the drum they march to. They march to the beat of Jesus's heart. And Jesus said, the greatest in his kingdom are children. And I think of what Elisha said. He said, bring out the minstrel that I may prophesy. Sometimes it's when we hear Z tickling the ivories that the Lord really opens up our hearts to speak to us in a powerful way. And my heart for us is that we would, as we get older, grow more childlike. G.K. Chesterton, he said, the Ancient of Days is younger than we because we have sinned and grown old. Children, they have yet to learn that there's anything that isn't music, but God, who is our creator, the Bible says the angels were singing when he created the worlds. The Bible says when he was flicking the stars into space with his fingers, and actually the psalm says he breathed stars. When's the last time you were breathing, you were yawning, and a star popped out of your esophagus? This is how powerful and amazing our Maker is. And the Bible says when he was creating everything, he was doing it to the music of angels. Indeed, the muses were singing, and the angels with their golden pipes were singing as if the heavens were pouring honey down the ears of human beings as they were being made. I love how creative our God is. And God, he is somebody who remains childlike. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He doesn't grow old. He doesn't grow jaded. And there is a time in our life where we cease to hear the music, where suddenly the birds chirping, we don't even think about it because all we can think about is the dings our phone makes when the emails are going off. And we can't think about the joy of exploring the redwood forest because we have 5 meetings tomorrow. And we can't even think about living movies because we're too busy watching movies. And we can't even think about the high of the Holy Ghost of just waking up in the morning and being alive as a child of God. Instead, what we're thinking about is the dopamine that is activated in our cranial package when we pull out our phones 150 times per day, once every 6 minutes, statistics are telling us. And my heart for us is that we would be so childlike that we would chase the setting suns, that we would understand that moons are there for feet to tread and the stars ignite God's plans, that we would be the kind of people who have yet to learn there is anything that isn't music. And there comes a time in our life where we're going to be threatened to be jaded. And what we're going to want to do is we're just going to want to go with the flow. And that's why, honestly, I really do get criticized for this on social media. Like somebody commented the other day, I was talking about how kids laugh 400 times every day, 200 to 400 times every day. The average adult laughs 13 to 17 times every day. And I said, you know, I want to be like a kid. And if people criticize me for being childish, I say, I agree with Jesus. Kids are the best. And so somebody commented, they're like, Ben, there's a difference between being childish and childlike. Absolutely. Jesus said, the greatest are the children. But listen, Paul said, when I became a man, I put away childish things. But what is being childish? Being childish is not getting on a skateboard. Being childish is being a little brat and pointing your finger at other people because you're mean. Love your enemies, dab on them haters, man. My mom was just talking about that to me recently, and I'm like, that's actually really good. Being childish doesn't mean, okay, I don't want to be childish, so I'm not going to have fun. Being childish means you're a little brat. Mine, 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 mine. I can judge you, 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 and all the good things are mine, 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 mine. And they're growing old and growing jaded. We dab on them haters, we love our enemies, but we're not going to cease to be childlike. In fact, I want to get more childlike the older I get. And the more people criticize me for it, the more fuel it gives me. Because they say, I'm sorry, but I don't want to be like you. I love you to pieces, but I'm not going to grow old and jaded. I'm going to be more childlike. I'm going to be filled with more wonder. I want more innocence. I want more naivety. I want more wisdom, which is not delivered to the sages. It's delivered to the babes and sucklings, for they cry out, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And if they don't cry out, even the rocks will cry out. But I believe he is the rock of ages who rolls the stone away. So why wouldn't I make music for him as a little child for the kingdom? Would somebody say amen? Now listen to this. Listen to this. I'm not like a huge fan, and I'm gonna maybe take some heat for this, but really hear me. I'm not like a huge fan of the title Christian. Well, let me tell you why. Christian is a human construct that the world created as a mockery of Jesus followers. What they were actually called is the sect of the Nazarene. So if you're trying to be like Acts, you should say, when people say, hey, you know, what faith do you have? You say, I'm the sect of the Nazarene. Sounds like a cult, but it's actually more biblical. They were also called the Way. I believe only one instance that I'm aware of in the scriptures are people who have faith in Jesus, are they called Christians? And it was when the world was trying to make fun of them. It literally means Christ folk. Oh, they're the Christ folk. They're the crazies out there. So Paul the Apostle, for example, he doesn't call you to be a Christian when he writes 2/3 of the New Testament. Like Paul the Apostle, he called you to be a child of God. That's why I want to kind of shift the rhetoric and syntax and diction in regards to, Ray, how we talk about our faith. It's not me trying to be religious and me trying to be a good Christian, you know, don't drink, don't chew, don't hang with those who do and follow a bunch of rules and regulations. My heart is that I would live like a child of God. That's what the Bible calls me. The Bible calls me a child of God. That's what I'm about. You know, a lot of people are coming up to me now. They're like, Ben, you don't seem like super religious. And I say, that's because I'm not. I'm not religious. I am a child of God. That's not religion. That's relationship. And religion is all about putting burdens on you. Relationship is all about being a child of God and loving the Lord. It's not about loving rules and regulations. I said this recently. But listen to this. Jesus said, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So when somebody comes to you and, you know, quotes the Old Testament and says, brother, I have a burden on my heart to share with you. And they say, brother, and they put their hand on your shoulder. I have a burden to share with you, and it's heavy on my heart. And it's not easy sharing this. I'm like, okay, well, you just said three things that Jesus said he's not about. Number one, burdens. He said, my burden is light. And Jesus said, if you're carrying burdens, come to me and I'll give you rest. Number two, you're laying heavy truth on me. Well, let me tell you about heavy. Jesus said, you who are heavy laden, come to me and I will give you peace. I'll give you rest. And you're saying, it's hard what I gotta do. It's hard what I gotta share with you. Jesus said, my yoke is easy. So I'll take what Jesus says. And it's not just religion that tries to do this to us, that tries to make us old and jaded. It's also the world. The world constantly tries to tell us, you're gonna die. You're gonna die soon. But I wanna tell the world, hey, you ain't dead yet. And the fact of the matter is, death is just like passing from womb to world. It's like going from caterpillar to butterfly. It's like watching the Minions movie to then moving on to Star Wars. That is how great the jump is gonna be from this life to the next. It's gonna be amazing. Jesus said, whoever believes on him who hath sent me has, past tense, passed from death into life. Eternal life doesn't start when you die. Eternal life starts now. And it just continues on for the rest of eternity. This is how I look at it metaphysically. Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is within you. So when I die, the kingdom of heaven, which is already inside me, is just gonna explode from my projected self and is just gonna burst all around me and I can't die. Because scientifically, energy and matter cannot be created nor destroyed. Scientists sometimes like to tell you that you are nothing more than materialism. You are swirling particles and atoms. You are nothing more than the sum of your knowable parts, your eyelashes and eyebrows and a belly button and toenails. But Jesus says, I am more than the sum of my knowable parts. He says, I have a soul. And a soul, like matter and energy, cannot be created nor destroyed. Why? Because my soul, my spirit, comes from a God that cannot be created. Therefore, it stands to reason that I cannot be destroyed. So when people tell me, you're gonna be coal for humans of the future to dig up because you're nothing more than matter, and ultimately you're gonna go in someone's chimney, and you're gonna be smoke floating around in the ether for the rest of eternity until your atoms join with some distant star, and that is your destiny, I say, that ain't my destiny, because like energy, I come from a God who cannot be created. Therefore, it stands to reason that I cannot be destroyed. Jesus said, whoever believes will not die. I'll take that verse. I'll take that verse. He who believes in me will not die. You pass from death into life. That's why Christian funerals versus atheist funerals are so different. Because when you know you're a child of God, it's all a big celebration. Even death can't stop you. We are invincible. Some young people, they go to their parents and their parents tell them, you aren't invincible. You think you're indestructible. But you know what you can tell your parents? I love you so much, but I am invincible and I am indestructible. I am every bit as indomitable as I believe myself to be because my soul cannot be destroyed. I will live forever. Oh, and P.S., by the way, I'm gonna get a glorified body too, according to Paul. So it's gonna be pretty dope all the way around, no matter how you slice it. It's good, man. It's good news. So we should be more childlike. This week was kind of crazy. I was speaking in Utah yesterday. Before that, I was shooting a mini movie for our TV show in California. And in one 24-hour period, we skateboarded inside a grocery store. We jumped onto a moving train and caught a moving train at 3:30 a.m. And there was so much like smoke around. It looked like God was a rock star and it was his angelic smoke machine. There's just so much fog. We went to the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco and went up to this secret spot that I'd never seen before and just looked over the Golden Gate Bridge and I was just wrecked. And I remember what neurologists say, that something awful that happens to you, it sticks like Velcro to your brain. And that's why if 10 people say something beautiful to you, 9 people say something beautiful to you, and 1 person says something cruel, you remember the cruel thing because that's how our brains work. Our cranial package and psychological constitution, it sticks like Velcro to the bad stuff. And neurologists say, so what you have to do is when something beautiful happens, in order for your gray cells to assimilate and process that information, you have to stop for 15 seconds. And during those 15 seconds, you meditate Philippians 4:8 on what's true, noble, lovely, just, pure, virtuous, and praiseworthy. And that's how it actually sticks to your cranial package. So I was there at the Golden Gate Bridge and my friend who was with me, Cam, he's like, hey Ben, we gotta go. My girlfriend's waiting in the car. I'm like, Cam, I need 15 more seconds. I gotta lock this thing in. and I'm looking at the Golden Gate Bridge as the air is just blowing in my face at night, and the gemscape of San Francisco and the skyline is there on the horizon, and I'm looking at all of this beauty. And then I realize, wait, this is how life should be every day, every day. Like yesterday in Utah, there's these beautiful snow-capped mountains everywhere. And I look at, like, the other day I saw a huge Christmas tree that was like 100 feet tall. I jumped a fence and climbed to the top of this like building to like look down at the billion fairy lights as this Christmas tree was afire with phosphorescence and luminescence. I'm like, this is amazing. Everything is magical. Look at this. This is just enchanted. We are in Narnia. And if we lose the wonder, if we lose our childlike joy, we've missed it. Yesterday I was sharing with the group there in Lehi that this thing's all magic, dude. There are 150 subatomic particles, 150. Do you realize we didn't even discover the atom until the 1800s? And then in the 1800s, we found out everything's made up of atoms, but an atom is so small that it is in size to a golf ball what a golf ball is in size to the world, to the planet Earth. It's just a tiny thing. And since then, through our microscopes, we've discovered 150 more subatomic particles, and these particles are just filthy. Like, one subatomic particle, electron, does not face the front when you spin it 360 degrees. For that to happen, you have to spin it 720 degrees for it to face the front. You say, wait, no, a 360 makes you face the front. Well, not in the subatomic realm. In the microscopic realm, because of quantum mechanics, they actually defy Newtonian physics and pull the rug out from science as we know it. And ever since the last 150 years, we're like, okay, wait, this thing's more magical and less predictable than we imagined. There are subatomic particles that leap from point A to point B without traveling the distance in between. There are subatomic particles, they call that quantum leaping. Do you want to know why they call it quantum leaping? Because scientists are too afraid to call it teleportation, which is actually what it is. They would feel dumb if they said, oh, that electron just did a beam me up Scotty maneuver, but that's what it did. They just don't call it that because Niels Bohr said, if you actually study quantum theory and you're not outraged, you don't know what's being said. Werner Heisenberg, who discovered the uncertainty principle that you cannot predict both the position and momentum of a quantum particle simultaneously, said that when you take the first sip of the natural sciences, it will make an atheist out of you, but God is waiting for you at the bottom of the glass. Come on, man. That's amazing. The best scientists are believers in God. Nominal scientists, they're atheists. When you do a cursory reading of science or you go to college as a freshman, why do you think all these college freshmen are becoming atheists? Because they don't know anything. And then they get introduced to science and they take one sip and they're like, I'm an atheist now. But the greatest scientists, in fact, one of the greatest astronomers, one of the greatest French astronomers to ever live, said, you cannot be an astronomer and an atheist at the same time. It's impossible. When you discover how tiny this little rock is in an insignificant solar system, in a menial galaxy, that there are actually 6,000 stars visible to the naked eye, popping like sapphires against the inky velvet of interstellar void. 6,000 stars visible to the naked eye every night, but there are more than 100 billion stars in our galaxy, and billions of other galaxies are known. You're like, what is this thing? Am I in Gryffindor or Slytherin? Because this thing is enchanted. When you discover a neutron star that weighs more than all the continents on the Earth put together, it is heavier than all the continents on the Earth put together, and it fits inside a teaspoon. Like, that's not the reaction I was waiting for. Watch this. A neutron star weighs more than 200 billion tons. That's more than all the continents on the Earth put together, and it fits inside a teaspoon? You're telling me this thing isn't magic? Albert Einstein said, either you believe that everything is a miracle or nothing is a miracle. And for me, as for me, I'm not gonna go through life as though nothing were a miracle. I'm not gonna go through life believing that everybody's just matter, a swirling quantum carbon footprint. I believe that we are more than the sum of our knowable parts, because there are electrons that can do 47,000 laps around a 4-mile tunnel in 1 second. There are electrons that exist in two places at the same time. There are subatomic particles that pop into existence out of nowhere. They've discovered subatomic particles that exist everywhere and nowhere at the same time. They've discovered quantum entanglement, which means if you turn a particle in LA, a particle in New York will mirror it, and they're actually theorizing that that's through quantum wormholes, and they're leaping through quantum wormholes like we're gonna do hopefully one day in space. Like, we're gonna leap through quantum wormholes to travel to distant galaxies, because that's the only way we'll have enough fuel to do so. But these quantum particles are leaping through many theorized wormholes in order to communicate and mirror a particle in LA and New York. They have no line of communication, yet they demonstrate awareness of each other. You're telling me that's not miraculous? This thing is miraculous. There are actually quantum physicists who say, and this is a fact, that when you observe, when you merely look at, behold, observe a quantum particle, it will change its behavior based on your observation, which goes according to German idealism as a metaphysic, which is nutty if you plumb the deeps and don't skim the surface. But if you observe a quantum particle, it will actually change its behavior. And there are actually scientists who theorize that if you are not observing a quantum particle, it doesn't even exist. It doesn't even exist. So the question is, when we're not observing the far reaches of outer space, when we're not observing the wall behind us, when there are things that we're not observing, how are they in existence if there's nobody to observe them? How are these atoms and subatomic particles, how are they existing if there's no one to observe them? The answer is simple. Hebrews, all things are naked and exposed before God's eyes. He's the ever-present observer. He's the great I am. He's watching everything, and his eyes are keeping everything in existence. So I don't want to become somebody, even when I study science, who grows jaded. Like, that doesn't make sense. This thing should make me more enthusiastic, more joyful, more buoyant. Because I know in life, sometimes that wonder will be sapped out of you. Sometimes there are people who just try to grind their atheistic pessimism into you. But what you've got to say is, what you make in my life, what you make in my life that seems painful, I will convert it into pain fuel. And you say what doesn't kill me makes me stronger, and that's true, but I want to say what Jesus says: even if it kills me, it makes me stronger, because even if I die, I'll be more powerful than you've ever dreamed, as Obi-Wan Kenobi would say, because I am an immortal soul and I'm about to get a glorified body. Amen. You are not a carbon footprint, you're a child of God. You are not swirling particles, you are a force to be reckoned with. You are not merely a body with a soul. You're a soul that just so happens to have a body. You're a powerhouse. You're a child of God. And it's time we go out there and change this rock. We are seeing a movement right now. It's unlike anything I've ever seen in my life. I am seeing so many young people not just having faith in God at this point, but they're actually like selling out for him. They're becoming so, everywhere I go, I'm seeing this not only on social media, but even everywhere I travel, more and more people are like, I'm turning on to this thing. Because enthusiasm isn't something that's taught, it's something that's caught. And when you're ever around somebody who's got the fire, that fire doesn't burn you, it just burns what you are not, because you are an image of the consuming fire, which is God. And when you catch that fire, you're like, okay, I want this, I'm in, let's do this thing. And all around the country, really, we're seeing young people waking up to the God of hope, that life doesn't have to be perfect, it just has to be lived. Jesus said, I've come that you might live, that you might live eternally, abundantly, more and better life than you ever dreamed of, as John 10:10 says. And we're seeing young people getting passionate about the Lord, getting enthusiastic about the Lord, not because of religion. Religion isn't cutting it anymore. It's because of a relationship with the God of hope. And that's what Jesus was about. He was so, he pitted himself against the assembled might of Jewish orthodoxy. He even split their temple veil because the Jews had done what all religion does. They had built a veil that separated God from man, and the only person who could go into God's presence was the pastor, was the priest, because that's what the Israelites wanted. On Mount Sinai, they said, Moses, you talk to us. We don't want to hear from God ourselves. we want you to talk to us. And God's like, I'd like to talk to you. But they're like, no, 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 we don't want to hear God. We want to hear Moses tell us about God. And the same thing happens today. We put this veil here and we say, we want a pastor to tell me about God. We want a priest to tell me about God. And Jesus says, wait, I am the way. I am the great high priest. You can come boldly to the throne of grace to obtain mercy and help in time of need. Every single one of you, from the youngest to the oldest, no matter what your past is, no matter what worries you have for the future, no matter what sins you've committed in the past, every single one of you, you have faith in the Lord. You can come boldly to the throne of grace and talk to the creator of neutron stars and talk to the creator who made flamingos, which can only eat when their heads are upside down, and talk to the creator of albatross birds who fly 25 miles per hour while sleeping, and talk to the creator of ostriches, which are the tallest birds on planet Earth and sometimes step on their own eggs because they're really clumsy and God has a sense of humor. You can talk to the God who created In-N-Out, which tastes like love without the fear of love's dissolution. You have access, and you're a child of God. The Bible doesn't emphasize you as a woman of God. That's what we call people. Oh, she's a woman of God. She's a prayer warrior. Where do you see that phrase in the New Testament? It's not, you're a man of God. Oh, he's a man of God. You're a man of the cloth. You're a man of God, aren't you? You don't really dress like one, look like one, talk like one, or act like one, but technically, I got a DM today. Do you have a license to preach? I'm like, I don't even know how to answer that question. Do I have a license to preach? That's like how we think today. Oh, you need to be ordained. You need to have a license, whatever. But that's old covenant stuff. That's religiosity. That's churchianity. The truth is, the Bible doesn't call you a man of God. The Bible doesn't call you a woman of God. The Bible calls you a child of God. We're gonna have to stop for now, but here's a little sneak peek at what you're gonna see in the upcoming show. The Bible says the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives in your mortal body to quicken you to life. And once you discover that the superpowers are already lying dormant inside of you, you as a child of God are gonna destroy hell and populate heaven for a living. Come on. If people say I'm not down to earth, that's okay with me, because I'd rather be up to heaven. What are you up to today? Is it heaven? Our business is to bring the kingdom of heaven down to earth. And we do that by being more childlike. Remember, being childish is being a spoiled brat, but being childlike is being full of hope and joy. So glad you tuned in to Joyful, Confident Welcome. And I'm your host, Ben Courson. You've been watching Hope Generation, and we will see you later, Hope Generators. I can't tell you how much your stories of hope have impacted the team of Hope Generation to know that lives are being changed by the message of the God of Hope. If you would like to access more hope content, check out our Instagram page, our YouTube videos, hear our radio broadcasts, access our app and podcasts, you can visit bencourson.com.